Random House Audio presents Hannibal Rising by Thomas Harris. This is the author, Thomas Harris. Hannibal Rising. Prologue. The door to Dr. Hannibal Lecter's memory palace is in the darkness at the center of his mind, and it has a latch that can be found by touch alone. This curious portal opens on immense and well-lit spaces, early Baroque, and corridors and chambers rivaling in number and variety those of the Topkapi Museum. Everywhere there are exhibits, well-spaced and lighted, each keyed to memories that lead to other memories in geometric progression. Spaces devoted to Hannibal Lecter's earliest years differ from the other archives in being incomplete. Some are static scenes, fragmentary, like painted attic shards held together by blank plaster. Other rooms hold sound and motion, great snakes wrestling and heaving in the dark and lit in flashes. Pleas and screaming fill some places on the grounds where Hannibal himself cannot go. But the corridors do not echo screaming, and there is music if you like. The palace is a construction begun early in Hannibal's student life. In his years of confinement, he improved and enlarged his palace, and its riches sustained him for long periods while warders denied him his books. Here, in the hot darkness of his mind, let us feel together for the latch. Finding it, let us elect for music in the corridors, and looking neither left nor right, go to the Hall of the Beginning, where the displays are most fragmentary. We will add to them what we have learned elsewhere, in war records and police records and interviews, in mute forensics, in the postures of the dead. By our efforts we may watch as the beast within turns from the teat and, working upwind, enters the world. Book 1. This is the first thing I have understood. Time is the echo of an axe within a wood. Philip Larkin. Chapter 1. Hannibal the Grim, 1365 to 1428, built Lecter Castle in 5 years, using for labor the soldiers he had captured at the Battle of Zalgiris. On the first day his pennant flew from the completed towers, he assembled the prisoners in the kitchen garden, and mounting his gallows to address them, he released the men to go home, just as he had promised. Many elected to stay in his service, owing to the quality of his provender. 500 years later, Hannibal Lecter, 8 years old and eighth of the name, stood in the kitchen garden with his little sister Misha and threw bread to the black swans on the black water of the moat. Misha held on to Hannibal's hand to steady herself and missed the moat entirely on several throws. Big carp stirred the lily pads and sent the dragonflies soaring. Now the alpha swan came out of the water, stumping toward the children on his short legs, hissing his challenge. The swan had known Hannibal all his life, and still he came, his black wings shutting out part of the sky. "Oh, Hannibal," Misha said, and hid behind Hannibal's leg. Hannibal raised his arms to shoulder height, as his father had taught him to do, his reach augmented with willow branches held in his hands. The swan stopped to consider Hannibal's greater wingspan and retired to the water to feed. "We go through this every day," Hannibal told the bird. But today was not every day, and he wondered where the swans could flee. Misha, in her excitement, dropped her bread on the damp ground. When Hannibal stooped to help her, she was pleased to dab mud on his nose with her little star-shaped hand. He dabbed a bit of mud on the end of her nose, and they laughed at their reflections in the moat. The children felt 3 hard thumps in the ground, and the water shivered, blurring their faces. The sound of distant explosions rolled across the fields. Hannibal grabbed up his sister and ran for the castle. The hunting wagon was in the courtyard, hitched to the great draft horse Caesar. Burnt in his hostler's apron and the houseman Lothar loaded 3 small trunks into the wagon box. Cook brought out a lunch. "Master Lecter, Madam wants you in her room," Cook said. Hannibal passed Misha along to Nanny and ran up the hollowed steps. Hannibal loved his mother's room with its many scents, the faces carved in the woodwork, its painted ceiling. Madam Lecter was of the Sforza on one side and a Visconti on the other, and she had brought the room with her from Milan. She was excited now, and her bright maroon eyes reflected the light redly in sparks. Hannibal held the casket as his mother pressed the lips of a cherub in the molding and a hidden cabinet opened. She scooped her jewels into the casket, and some bundled letters. There was not room for them all. Hannibal thought she looked like the cameo portrait of her grandmother that tumbled into the box. Clouds painted on the ceiling. As a baby nursing, he used to open his eyes and see his mother's bosom blended with the clouds, the feel of the edges of her blouse against his face. The wet nurse, too. Her gold cross gleamed like sunlight between prodigious clouds and pressed against his cheek when she held him, she rubbing the mark of the cross on his skin to make it go away before Madam might see it. But his father was in the doorway now, carrying the ledgers. Simonetta, we need to go. The baby linens were packed in Misha's copper bathtub, and Madam put the casket among them. She looked around the room and took a small painting of Venice from its tripod on the sideboard, considered a moment, and gave it to Hannibal. Take this to cook. Take it by the frame, she smiled at him. Don't smudge the back. Lothar carried the bathtub out to the wagon in the courtyard, where Misha fretted, uneasy at the stir around her. Hannibal held Misha up to pat Caesar's muzzle. She gave the horse's nose a few squeezes as well to see if it would honk. Hannibal took grain in his hand and trailed it on the ground in the courtyard to make an M. The pigeons flocked to it, making an M in living birds on the ground. Hannibal traced the letter in Misha's palm. She was approaching 3 years old, and he despaired of her ever learning to read. M for Misha, he said. She ran among the birds laughing, and they flew up around her, circling the towers, lighting in the belfry. Cook, a big man in kitchen whites, came out carrying a lunch. The horse rolled an eye at Cook and followed his progress with a rotating ear. When Caesar was a colt, Cook had run him out of the vegetable garden on a number of occasions, yelling oaths and swatting his rump with a broom. I'll stay and help you load the kitchen, Mr. Yakov said to the cook. Go with the boy, Cook said. Count Lecter lifted Misha into the wagon, and Hannibal put his arms around her. Count Lecter cupped Hannibal's face in his hand. Surprised by the tingle in his father's hand, Hannibal looked closely into Count Lecter's face. 3 planes bombed the rail yards. Colonel Timka says we have at least a week if they reach here at all, and then the fighting will be along the main roads. We'll be fine at the lodge. It was the second day of Operation Barbarossa, Hitler's lightning sweep across Eastern Europe into Russia. Chapter 2. Bernt walked ahead of the wagon on the forest path, careful of the horse's face, hacking back the overgrown branches with a Swiss half-pike. Mr. Yakov followed on a mare, his saddlebags full of books. He was unused to horseback, and he hugged the horse's neck to pass beneath the limbs. Sometimes, where the trail was steep, he dismounted to push along with Lothar and Bernt and Count Lecter himself. Branches snapped back behind them to close the trail again. Hannibal smelled greenery crushed by the wheels and Misha's warm hair beneath his chin as she rode on his lap. He watched the German bombers pass over high. Their vapor trails made a musical staff, and Hannibal hummed to his sister the notes the black puffs of flak made in the sky. It was not a satisfying tune. No, Misha said. Hannibal, sing das Mannlein. And together they sang about the mysterious little man in the woods, Nanny joining in the swaying wagon, and Mr. Yakov singing from horseback, though he preferred not to sing in German. Ein Mannlein steht im Walde ganz still und stumm. Es hat von lauter Purpur ein Mantlein Sag, wer mag das Mantlein sein, das steht im Waldelein mit dem purpurroten Mantelein. 2 hard hours brought them to a clearing beneath the canopy of the high forest. The hunting lodge had evolved over 300 years from a crude shelter into a comfortable forest retreat, half-timbered with a steep roof to shed the snow. There was a small barn containing 2 stalls and a bunkhouse, and behind the lodge a Victorian privy with gingerbread carvings, its roof just visible over the screening hedge. Still visible in the foundations of the lodge are the stones of an altar built in the Dark Ages by a people who venerated the grass snake. Now Hannibal watched a grass snake flee that ancient place as Lothar cut back some vines so Nanny could open windows. Count Lecter ran his hands over the big horse while it drank 1.5 gallons from the well bucket. Cook will have the kitchen packed by the time you get back, Bernt. Caesar can rest in his own stall overnight. You and Cook start back here at first light, no later. I want you well clear of the castle by morning. Vladis Grutus entered the courtyard of Lecter Castle with his most pleasant expression, scanning the windows as he came. He waved and called out, "Hello!" Grutus was a slight figure, dirty blonde in civilian clothes, with eyes so pale and blue they looked like disks of the empty sky. He called out, "Hello in the house!" When there was no reply, he went in the kitchen entrance and found cases of supplies packed on the kitchen floor. Quickly, he put coffee and sugar.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.